Gumper.
Twilight, you're not meant to wake me up. I was in the middle of dreaming of my young days when I went up in time to space in the moon. What? Visitors? Where? When? Oh, hello. I didn't see you coming, except you saw me sleep. So humiliating. I suppose you'll want me to show you around as I do some songs and read one book. But all right. This is the room. The first room. First bedroom. That's in the way. Oh, hello. A little koala. You want to draw this song? Here we go round the murder bus, the murder bus, the murder bus. Here we go round the murder bus on a cold and frosty morning. This is the way we clean the mess, clean the mess, clean the mess. This is the way we clean the messy droplets on a cold and frosty morning. This is a paper, pretend it's a book. This is the way we read and learn, read and learn, read and learn. This is the way we read and learn on a cold and frosty morning. Here we go round the murder bus, the murder bus, the murder bus. Here we go round the murder bus on a cold and frosty morning. What? What? Oh dear, you got a bit dizzy then. Now then, about the piano. I could play you the song about koalas. They're cute and cuddly, but they don't like being called bears. There it is. This black piano I've played. It's called Please Don't Call Me Koala Bear. I've not played this for years. Yes, here we go. stop it. No, stop that. That was misstep. It was a good practice. Now lead you one story. I found a person in pet book. I've already read some to you yesterday. Look at that. This book. Hirschman Pets Treasure Hunt. That's what I haven't read. Hirschman Pets Treasure Hunt. Pat is the Green Dale Hirschman. He drives in his red van every day up the valley, twisting along twining roads and up and over the hills, far away down the narrow lanes and tracks to farms and cottages, by village, school and church, along by lakes and streams he goes, all over the valley. Everyone is glad to see him. He brings letters and cards, newspapers and magazines. He brings football balls and catalogues, bills and birthday cards, and parcels full of all knows what. He also brings a smile, a joke, or a chat, news of the vendor, who's doing what? He's cheerful and friendly, and brightens every day. He has a little black cat called Jess. Jess rides in a basket next to Pat. Jess keeps an eye on things. Each morning, Pat collects the day's post from the village post office. Mrs. Goggins sorts the letters and parcels ready for Pat to deliver, as well as looking after the shop. One sunless spring morning, Pat walked into the post office with a cheerful, "Good morning, Mrs. Goggins." "Morning to you, Pat," said Mrs. Goggins. "And a busy one too. Just look at all these letters and parcels. And most of them from young Kate and Tom Partridge, it seems," said Pat. "Well, of course, it's their birthday," said Mrs. Goggins, smiling. "So it is," said Pat. "Mrs. Partridge was busy icing the cake yesterday. Aren't they lucky how excited they'll be when they see all their cards and parcels? I'd better be on my way. They'll be looking out for me. Goodbye. Goodbye, Pat." Pat began the day's round. His first stop was at the village school. It was a rather small school skeleton in it. Most of them came in a minibus that connected them from their farms and cottages. They arrived early, long before Mr. Pringle, the headmaster, drove up in a modest manner, lowered one. Pat arrived early too. The children are playing in the yard. They came running up to Pat. Each wanted something to tell him, and Pat usually had a joke to tell or something to tease them with. Bill Thompson was the eldest, and it was his job to look after the school's letters before Mr. Pringle arrived. This morning, someone gave him a push, and he dropped the letters, oh dear, right in a puddle. The ink began to run. He wiped them on his shirt and made a lovely inky pattern all down his front. Sarah Gilbertson was showing Pat a fossil so he didn't notice. Then Sarah and Lucy Selby asked Pat if he was good at hopscotch, as they had just had new lines painted in the yard. "Well, it's a long time since I played," said Pat Dunphy. He had a try in a way. He was quite good at it. But it made his postman's hat joggle up and down. He was enjoying the hopscotch so much that he almost forgot the time. "Good gracious," he said, looking at his watch. "I'll have to be off. The post mustn't be late. Not a day for old days. Of all days." "What's special about today?" asked Sarah. "Wait and see," said Pat cheerio. "I'll see you tomorrow." A little further along the road, Pat turned in at the gates of Greendale Farm. As soon as they heard Pat's van coming, Kate and Tom Partridge came running out to meet him. When they saw the pile of letters and parcels in Pat's arms, all for them, they couldn't wait to open them. As they are twins, it was a double birthday. Mrs. Partridge came out with a pair of scissors, and they sat down on the grass and snipped their parcels open. They had some lovely presents, but Katie did not seem pleased with hers. "What's up with Katie?" asked Pat. "She's wrong side out today," said Mrs. Partridge. "She's lost Sarah Ann. Is that the little doe she takes to school?"
"She takes it everywhere," said Mrs. Partridge. "She's lost that, and I don't know what we'll do if it doesn't turn up."
"Oh, it's to turn up somewhere," said Pat. "The trouble is it could be almost anywhere," said Mrs. Partridge. "We went to see Aunt Alice yesterday and called at ever so many places on the way. She could have left it just anywhere." "I'll look for it," said Pat. "You'll never know. I might spot Sarah Ann in my travels. I'm good at finding things." "Poor Katie. She does look sad. I'll do my best. Don't worry now, Sarah." Pat was on his way again. In his red van, he told Jess about the lost doe. Where could Sarah Ann be? Jess looked thoughtful and kept a sharp lookout for any wandering does.
as it traveled from farm to farm. He could catch mice in the dark. So surely he could catch a doe in broad daylight. The next stop was the church. The Reverend Thames had her pet span coming and was looking out to see if there were any letters today. There was a card for him from his Aunt Joan on holiday in Majorca. Pat told him about Katie's lost doe. "She could have left it in the church," said the Reverend Tins. "She always brings it. Seek and thou shalt find. Let's have a look. Mind your head." They searched among the pews, looking under seats, lifting hassocks, moving piles of hymn books, creeping about and popping up in unexpected places. There were so many places to look in, in a church. At last the Reverend Tins did find something, but it was not Sarah Ann. It was a lady's glove. "Let me see. I think I know that glove," said Pat. "Look, it has letters sewn inside. D.T. Dorothy Thompson. That's what it is. It must be hers. I'll take it along for her. She will be pleased. Well, I hope Katie's doe turns up," said the Reverend Tins. "Let the Lord guide you and all will be well." "Yes, we'll keep looking till we find it," said Pat. "Thanks for helping. Goodbye." Pat drove up the steep hill to Thompson Ground. Mrs. Thompson was surprised when Pat gave her a glove and had letters. "Well, I never," she said. "Where did you find my glove? I've been looking everywhere for it." Then Pat told her about Katie's lost doe being lost. "We were looking in the church for it, and the Reverend found your glove instead." "Well, Katie and her mum did call in for a cup of tea on Monday. She could have left her doe here. Perhaps under caution. We'd better have a look." They searched everywhere. They lifted cushions. They looked on chairs and behind chairs. They peered behind the television set and amongst the coats that hung on the back of the door. They even looked over the sideboard out of the wall to see if Sarah Ann had slipped down the back. It was no good. They didn't find Katie's doe. But Mrs. Thompson found a knife down the side of a chair. "That's Ted Glenn's knife," said Pat. "It's his rabbiting knife. Goodness knows when he left it here. He hasn't been here since last Christmas," said Mrs. Thompson. "I'll take it along for him," said Pat. "He will be pleased to have it back." "I hope you'll find Katie's doe," said Mrs. Thompson. "We'll keep looking. See you tomorrow. Cheerio. Cheerio, Pat." Pat drove down the steep and winding road and along the valley to Ted Glenn's cottage. Jess kept a sharp lookout for the lost doe. "What a day," said Pat. "We found a glove and a knife, but no Sarah Ann. I wonder if We will find her. I do hope so. Hope so. Just twitched his whiskers, hopefully. Ted Glenn's denied deceased knife. He couldn't guess where Pat had found it. Pat told him about Kate's lost girl. Ted said, they popped in yesterday with a lamp they wanted mending. She could have left the door, yeah? So, they went to have a look in Ted's workshop. Oh dear, what a jungle it was. There were things everywhere. All the things that people had brought to be mended. There were toys, and television sets, cookers and cake stands, bikes and roller skates, farm machines and house machines, more than you could count. Goodness knows when Ted would mend them all. Likely enough, most of them had been quite forgotten by their owners. And what a dreadful place it was in which to seek the dough. There were so many things that they could hardly move. They lifted things, they fell over things, things fell on them. Oops. They moved things, they tossed things, they looked over things, they looked round things, under things, behind things, between things, beside things. They did not find Sarah Ann, but Ted found a watch that he'd mended and forgotten about. That's Miss Hubbard's, he said. She bought it to be thankful last Christmas. Would you take it to Longfather, Pat? She'll be needing it. Certainly, I'm going that way. I hope you'll find the dough, said Ted. So do I, said Pat. I seem to be able to find plenty of other things. Uh-oh. That's not good. It's a bit of a loose stream. I want to pull the page. Pat drove along the valley to Southland's farm cottage, where Miss Hubbard lives. The mobile shop was already there. And Miss Hubbard was doing her shopping, filling a basket with groceries. She was pleased to see Pat, and even more pleased when he handed over the watch with her letters. Though she couldn't guess where Pat had found it, Sam came to see what they were talking about and to add up Miss Hubbard's shopping. Sam drives a mobile shop, so Pat told them about Kate's lost doll, but they hadn't seen it. Poor Kate, said Pat, and on her birthday too. I'll buy her a box of chocolates to cheer her up. As we haven't found Sarah Ann, Pat took a box of chocolates from the shelf of the mobile shop. There was something else on the shelf. A squashed up something that had been behind the box of chocolates. What's that, said Pat, behind your chocolates? I don't know, said Sam. It's nothing I put there. Pat pulled the bundle out and straightened it and smoothed it. I know what it is, said Pat. It's a dough, said Miss Hubbard. I don't sell doughs, said Sam. It isn't a new one, said Miss Hubbard. It's Kate's dough, said Pat. There's a name sewn in the skirt. It must be Server Anne, the one we've been looking for all day. Sam was amazed. That young Katie Potter, he said, she gets everywhere. I'll take the chocolates away, said Pat. They'll make a nice birthday gift present. Jess guarded Server Anne all the way back to Katie's farm. He wasn't going to let her snip away again. And when Pat arrived at the twins' birthday party with Server Anne and the chocolates, Katie smiled properly for the first time that day. She hugged Server Anne and Pat and Jess and said thank you to them all. Pat just had to join in the party and Jess sat beside him. There were some, there was tea and cakes. For Pat and a sauce of cream for Jess. It was a good party. Then Pat looked at his watch and said, time we were off. Goodbye, everyone. Have a good time. Goodbye, Pat. Goodbye. Everyone called. Off and Pat and Jess in the red van. Pat still had to collect the letters from the letterbox in Thomas's Goggins, all about his treasure hunt for Katie's lost stone. Well, that's the end of my preschool film based on Mr. Whiskers' favorite nursery rhymes. I'll see you next time. That's the end of this new film. He was great.